Did you notice it that it was posted? No, you don't go to this community page?
No, I go to community page.
Okay. Sujal?
Yeah.
Vin?
This is
the
one
meter.
Yeah.
You didn't read?
I don't remember.
You, well, you did it or you did not do it, this one?
Oh, from the guy from Yahoo.
No? Everything? Yes. Yeah? Vishuddha?
No, not this one.
Why not?
Yeah.
Which one?
Yeah.
The this one was really. Yeah. But that is that's an introduction, not really a search thing.
It was like summarize everything. If somebody wants to go through anything.
Was a quick summary.
Yes.
Scratch the surface.
So that's good. All right. So we discussed, I think, pretty much this particular one presentation, right? Now that most of you have seen also the Yahoo thing, and he's talking about Yahoo search in 2002, look at this article that I posted was discussing something that was done in year 2000, right? So, formulate in your own mind how things relate and how things have changed. Now, we were discussing this, and now I want to we actually didn't discuss. Sonic, please try to come in time. Indexing Yahoo photo search. Did we discuss this? I don't think we discussed this much. Does anybody want to pick up what this thing says here, and what more could be done? Or this is to take as much information as possible from multimedia, right? What more, you know, that is from text, right? If you want to use Alchemy API, that would be using text, right? What more can you do?
From whatever papers I have read, when they're crawling for images, they look for these height and width, because to answer queries like I want close-ups of certain people, or
big
images or small images or something like that.
Yeah, but that's
so
all relative, right? Like, what's a big image? Talking like
big images in
32K by 32K, like gig by gig. I mean, that's all relative.
No, I think even Google Image does that, right?
It's good, like if you were looking for wallpapers for your desktop or whatever, and you want a specific resolution of something, you could search for Grand Canyon or Mount Canyon or whatever. I don't know.
People may search for that, but how is it related to semantic search? What is the semantic out of that?
Maybe when you're putting in a query, like, give me a big image.
How big is big?
Yeah, something like
how do you know it's big?
Well, you can type in the pixel size, though, if you want to 1080p.
In that, you need to compute, and you need your program. program it to be able to compare the numbers, right? How big is big? But when you put it in Google, give me a big image, it does give a relatively, it just metadata of that image.
Let me see if I can show you something. I don't know if I can find the file. So, when there is a... look at this particular picture, if I can bring it up. So this is an image search engine that we have developed a while ago. And you see that there are three aspects of search happening here. One aspect of search is called keyword search, right? And you may type something here, let's say something garden, whatever that is. Here, it says flower garden, you know, flower garden, or something. Then it will look for what can it do? It can basically look for text around the images, and it would have indexed those words and would find like a traditional IR search engine. Here, you see there's a whole bunch of properties or attributes. So property would be image, content, picture type, country, price, height, flower color, fragrance, hybridizer, season. Right? So if you think about flower as a semantic object, then, and there's a model about flower, then you may say which season the flower grows in, what are the typical colors for the flower, this particular flower, what is the typical size of the flower, all this kind of stuff that can be had, right? Typically such things will be stored in a database, and people would have to manually type it in, or and then you'll be searching it, right? It doesn't magically occur. So clearly the intention, you don't have that information. In the example that I gave you, obviously you had your web page and your images, and you don't even necessarily know whether there's a flower image or not, right? So obviously you won't be automatically able to do this, right? So for that you'll have to do what you may always call as content-based search. So here you see color, composition, texture, and structure. Right? So these are typical image processing, in image processing algorithm would typically support this kind of stuff, right? Now, you might know that these days, for example, facial recognition systems have gotten very powerful. The commercial vendors that sell a facial recognition system, there are some countries where they will put cameras outside every game. So there's a big football game, let's say in Brazil, I have already started to put cameras outside every entrances. So when you go in the stadium, everybody's captured, and they have a database of all these bad people or undesired people, and in real time, near real time, it would flag when they find something, right? So there's a facial match, right? But here, of course, you know that the objects you deal with are faces of people, right? So clearly that certainly helps you. And then you have a database of people, and you have kind of learning-based algorithm, whereby they would have been trained to identify objects of that particular kind, the close match, and then it will flag you what is here. But to say for an image that this is a flower, just by itself is not quite possible. But if you gave the system 100 images of flower, then to find an image like that, implying that the image like that would be a flower image, is quite possible. Right? Because that's generally the kind of things that happens here. I believe, in my to my knowledge at least, this was the first system which combined these three kinds of search. Now understand this kind of stuff. We never discuss in our classes these three different kinds of search. You are well aware of, in a way, keyword search. You assume that, right? In semantic search, we have property-based search. Right? In the, for example, Tally's multimedia search engine, we had a movie. I have particular properties you can search by. Music has particular properties you can search by, right? Movie has its own model, like actor and studio and such. Music would have a recording label and artist and other sort of things like that. Similarly, baseball would have its own sort of stuff. So here, this is depending upon the type of object involved. In this case, flower, the flower specific properties come up. If I change to the different kind of object, then I would have different kind of things because I have schema or type description for every types of object that I'm going to do on semantic search, right? Now, what may happen is people may either do type specific search where you already have model a priori, or people may have a knowledge base of the kind that that indirectly comes from, let's say, the way big things were modeled in Wikipedia, right? And then you have the fact that certain info boxes are there, certain properties are there that people have identified, and they become indirectly. But there is it's not necessary that there is a type consistency of multiple objects of the same type across the knowledge base. So given an object, suppose you say the object is our stadium here, Nutter Center. And Nutter Center is there, and the particular properties that will come up, because Nutter Center is mentioned in Wikipedia and you can find what properties there are. But let's say now you can go to Yankee Stadium. Both of them are stadium of sorts, but different stadiums for different purposes. That distance may not be totally clear. It may be clear if you look at the thing and says this is primarily used for basketball, that the other is used for baseball. And let us look at another basketball stadium and compare against that too. But the properties for that may be different. Nevertheless, the model, the knowledge base may have all those properties, but they vary. So they're not the same. They're not consistently applied. Do you understand the difference? In one case, we have model ahead of the time. So the approach that Yahoo seemed to be taking, the approach that we took in Tally and in Wocat and Simagics, we had an ontology for the world, different types of objects in the world. We had ontology for entertainment, we had ontology for business objects, and so on and so forth. And those were models, so they had schema descriptions, and you try to complete as much as possible. To the level that I understand, some of the other alternatives, and Yahoo is doing the same thing, it has IMDb, it has its own model for movie databases. But if you look at, for example, say Google Knowledge Base or Freebase, does it have that? It doesn't have schema, as strong a schema as you could have, right? So there, you may have the properties, but you can match. Yankee Stadium, you will match. Then you say, oh, that is this property that is known in the knowledge base. But it won't be the fixed set for any other stadium. That same set of properties may not be available for other stadium, because in the knowledge base from which you got that information, let's say, from Wikipedia, that they are different, let's say. Right? It doesn't have that same strong typing as... War. War in Syria, okay.
So there might be attributes which is relevant to a war, and there might be other attributes relevant to a country, Syria. So in those cases, how are we going to combine the attributes?
You probably won't. War would have something of its own. Syria would have something of its own. And the whole concept of voice AI is typically not something that people are that able to model. So in fact, there's an interesting point here actually you're raising. If I'm using a static type system, it's unlikely that I will be able to model war in Syria. I will be able to model war in Syria, perhaps, but not that. If you're using untyped or loosely typed systems, then it's possible that there is an object war, is war in Syria, or currently civil war in Syria. And there is likely to be a Wikipedia, let's say, page, and you have modeled based on that, extracting based on that, or manually even describing what is there on the Wikipedia. Then it is possible that you would have different set of properties that are there that Wikipedia editors seem to have given. Right? So there you can now have complex objects. So there are pros and cons. Okay? Alright. So. No, I thought I gave you some information on this. Now, what happened was that if you have by chance looked at this paper. You would have seen some description of what kind of we did not discuss. I don't think we discuss. Okay. So you can see the kind of metadata that is extracted from structured and semi-structured text. Identifying both domain-specific, semantic, and domain-independent syntactic metadata, including those from audio-video content, speech-to-text data, and encoded metadata in the header. Right? So, when we have video, for example, or audio in this case also, we use speech-to-text conversion and then analyze the text. Plus, content encoded into header. So I recall the standard. So if you look at, for example, standard like MPEG, so if you look at these discussions here on MPEG 7 which is a standard that is used for encoding video content, then you'll find that there is a discussion on modeling metadata, and the way this thing works is that when you create a video content, let's say, typically you use an authoring system. Authoring system is a video processing system basically, and at that point you get a whole bunch of properties. Just like this, so just like you saw in that paper that I just showed you, it's gone now. The image thing I showed you, they are particularly object specific property types. So depending, you're authoring the video, this model here, MPEG model, has described how can you use certain semantic information, a piece of information. And that will then be embedded in the encoding that you have in the media object itself. So it travels with the object itself. And then it is easy for software to open that file and pick up the head encodings they have and use as metadata. That is what we did in this particular system.
Is it, this will be really great when searching video or audio file.
Mm-hmm.
Would be really great, but will this be scalable? I mean, having plenty of videos coming up on the web at the same time, generating this data, I mean, speech to text conversion is not a smooth process, it's a costly process. So is it a scale? I mean, I just want to know, is it scalable enough?
I think I mean, large systems like YouTube and others will have the ability to do that. I mean, they will have horsepower to do that. See, remember, when you're uploading video, the video is actually entirely processed.
Yeah.
At that point, the same the speech to text conversion, if there was one, would take less time and much less effect than the video processing computation that is happening at that time, because they are converting into the format conversion is happening for web suitability for so they're suitable for web. So yeah, it can be done. They are not doing it. I'm saying it can be done. The second thing is MPEG coding or encoding of the metadata that is there. There are at the risk of simplifying, there are two broad variety of video content or this kind of digital content. One is user author, another is professionally author. So anytime, think about any content that a reporter in the Syria war, if he is taking video or images, these are expensive things. They come into professional processing houses like AP News or Reuters, or CBS News has a major thing in New York, and they use professional systems. And you saw in this discussion, right? The New York Times discussion. You remember the this particular thing I'm talking about, this one here, right?
Yeah.
Where they have created whole framework for annotation. They have done it for tens of years now, right? So you can assume that major studios involving news, CNN and all that, would have those authoring systems where they would type in, human would do that, or menu selection or all that. Some of them may be automatically brought in. Some of them may be brought in from, for example, nowadays for any digital camera, video or audio, it's quite possible for them to capture the coordinates and time. So clearly that metadata would be captured. Right, but what is in the frame may not be captured. Whether there's a soldier or an ID or a gun or whatever, that is won't be captured automatically, right? And not everything has to be captured anyway. Okay, but there's a very popular video from the time of. The trials for Bill Clinton, Congress was was trying to unseat him, right? Those who were there would remember some words that were particularly used to search for videos. So, some people know this, okay. But the point here is that in this case, they did text-to-speech conversion. Switch to text conversion, and they had that. In fact, the software that we had, which we got from Viraj, which was a company founded by Ramesh Jain, had this thing built in. So today, Nuance and several other companies, the 2-3 companies that have highly scalable speech to text conversion system. In fact, if you think about it, almost a majority of increasing number of radiologists are using that. They are dictating. Today, when you go for a medical, for example, particularly anything related to radiology, then you have a report, right? All of these are dictated. Majority of them are dictated, some are dictated, some of them are menu-based system, and they take fragments and then they create the reports from that. So pseudo NLP systems are there to support them to build the reports. But there's a lot of, and then some of them are transcribed. A human hears and does the manuscript, does transcriptions, and then also. So, in any case, that can be done, right? And what happens is that beyond this MPEG 7, that is MPEG, I don't know whether, I used to follow this long time ago, but I don't know whether that is continuing that or not here. So MPEG 21, this is Moving Pictures Experts Group, right? That's what MPEG stands for. Was planning to develop very comprehensive semantic support. So let me see if I do. So you can see here, there's a bunch of work on things like this. Now, so we are back to the discussion here. So, there are, anybody wants to make comments? I certainly can make more comments, but what this thing has captured, this particular submission has captured. So, text conversion thing, right, is there? Also captured here is use of some, common descriptions, right? And use of schema, and possibly use of things like geonames to consistently tag the stuff, and then people use find. So there's a lot of things already discussed in this. More can be done, right? I'll use them to define category of an image. That's another ambitious thing. Did you read that? Since the base structure has clearly defined categories, I will use them too to define the category of the image. This is an interesting point, and I think whenever you're doing digital media, it's going to be very hard for you to automatically capture everything. So it's perfectly okay to come up with an approximate strategy. Which is a smart thing to do. At least it is scalable.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, somebody on the website has decided to put this under nature, right? Somebody has decided to put in the politics, so at least I would use that, right? That high level of granularity is still very useful. And so the whole point here is beauty is about capturing as much metadata as you can. I just showed you several more capabilities than what I think any one of you discussed here. It's a difficult problem. Okay, any other comments you guys want to make? Come on, guys, who were not participating last time, needs to speak up. That's a good summary. So what Mary says is that when you have digital media objects, you have text around that you can use it. You have metadata encoding. All of them use some encoding standards like MPEG or something. You have that, and you have processing, whether image processing or speech to text conversion of the video, speech to video to convert. So these are the three broad classes of metadata. Who among you have captured all that in your response?
Like two things actually. First is like whatever the text is around there. Second one is like identifying the object in the image actually. That one.
Okay. Now, Ulsilka, okay, all right.
Trust the people are telling you the context around it.
You have this problem with trusting people.
Well, yeah, because like, if you're going to build these things and like use people's like self-tag, I mean, people aren't getting, like, let's say most people aren't getting paid to tag these things. Right? So I'm sitting at home like, oh, that's a picture of the shore on the beach. Right? But what part of me doesn't just start tagging stuff as a lie? And then
so
my program comes through and starts grabbing that stuff and it's all completely wrong.
So, there's a game, what is the name of the game? Image tagging as a the game, what is it called?
Oh, it's the one that Christopher talked about.
Huh?
It's the one that Christopher talked about where it shows two pictures and people say what
yes.
it is.
Yeah, and that was something that was created by a guy who was still a student at CMU. And now he's a professor there, I think. What is his name? And now, so basically, so you look at all of these things, right? Image tagging as a game. The trust is essentially obtained by multiple people agreeing on doing that, right? So the idea is if independently two different people who don't know each other are taking the same, then they are right. That is, it's unlikely when you give the picture to you and picture to that, somebody else, and they don't know each other at different times, so they cannot have coordinated, lying together to have, cheated system. So that is one setting. The other example is also Wikipedia. How do you know? By and large, Wikipedia content is very trustworthy because there's so many, there's a process and there are so many people looking over your shoulder. So it is very hard for people to carry on any lie there.
So like if you grab a picture from Twitter, right, and you look at it, let's say you do, you look at it, you can't rely on the context it's in. You can score it.
So that's right. So then you can't trust as much when you are only looking at one source.
Mm-hmm.
So the two main approaches are when to use multiple people and see the agreement between them, or to have an editorial process like Wikipedia. So this is how you generally increase the trustworthiness. There are other things also whereby you analyze person's behavior over a long period of time and develop the trust, and that can always be somebody can always violate that, meaning the person who behaved very good all the time, but suddenly he's a hidden he's a terrorist, and he suddenly changes. He never had any, otherwise you didn't see him doing anything wrong, but now suddenly he does something, and that he goes sleeper, kind of thing. That can always happen, and so there is a problem with reputation based trust. This particular thing is reputation based trust. There are problems. There are other strategies where you analyze not just the person but his association.
Mm-hmm.
And just like PageRank works by analyzing all the other pages that point to you, to this page, the same way is to analyze all the other people who associate with this guy. So there are these strategies there where you can compute the trust measures. We have several papers and that discuss that. Pramod Anandram works on that particular topic. So yes, we have that. But just looking at one content, and you have very little information to trust, and you probably should not.
So did your search engine try and convolute a known database against an image or question?
No, in our case, we didn't have that problem at all.
So you didn't, did you guys try to do any convolution, any like correlation between your image and like a data set of images, so to make it learn without actually having people figure it out?
No, in this one here, we had, where is the paper, it's gone, but we had the those image processing capabilities that we had available. So give me images look like that, but nothing more than that.
So it wasn't like correlation, convolution, cross-correlation? It wasn't like in-depth image analysis?
No, it was a search engine. It was not the image processing system.
Okay.
It was using one in part, but not, okay. So, now let me ask you to... we don't have problem. Okay. So what you need to do, remember, is that you need to rate each of the three reviewers in how well they have done the review. So you need to rate 1Q7O0G7 and 1N3 and how well they did. A B C D E F, right? A B C D F. A B C D F grades. Right? Like the grade. So hopefully you've done that in your thing. You have to give me a then. So far as you have consistently applied against everybody, it's okay.
Because I have a lot of questions in the assignment and in the reviews.
Yeah, you know, I mean, the whole idea here is to comparatively rank them, and that happens, right? Just like in one first paper review, some people are more critical than others. So. I'll so far as it is fair across, and you know. Different reviews, you're okay.
We need to rate the reviews, right?
Yeah. Well, why don't you just go ahead and rank both the submission and the reviews?
That's
so
it, right? What did you mean by saying you have to write reviews?
No, just grade
the reviews.
Yeah, so is this 0A1 in the top 20%, maybe you give them. Give that A, but if it's not, then you know, like that, roughly, right? I want your submission to be rated along these five grades, and try to put 1/5 in A, 1/5 in B, 1/5 in C, 1/5 in B, and 1/5 in F. Okay. Otherwise, you're not doing your job. Ready to go to the next one? Each of you will have to kind of start discussing that. They don't have a choice. Otherwise, I'll pick randomly. Anybody, volunteers?
Discuss the paper.
So now submission. Now you know. Help me review this submission. Tell me what this reviewer does right, what this reviewer does wrong.
They did a good job of listing assumptions up front, but OB2, right? We had OB2. Okay. So they list two assumptions that the research was going to take, which is always good to do up front of the paper. The second assumption I thought was kind of a little weaker because it kind of got a little off topic, but then they broke it apart and like basically here's the data sets we used, here's the papers we used. And they did a pretty good job of explaining the news crunch and the news XML. The image one seemed to be a little, that's what I'm thinking about. Yeah, the image one seemed to be just a little bit skim the surface, but overall they did a pretty good job. There were some, they relied on background knowledge a lot without saying where they're going to get the background knowledge. So things like that may have put it apart, but could have been because they were page limited too. Like they want to write a lot about it because they saw it couldn't be any longer.
With the second assumption, I feel like the author is losing a lot of information.
Yeah, the second assumption, the last one, I thought, basically kind of cuts off like what semantic was, basically what the second assumption was. That's kind of what I thought.
But I think he used site URL somewhere when he, in the news ML, I guess. Since it is in schema, what's this? Schema central. Tries to ignore headers and all these.
assumption. It's possible. There is something that might be interesting. When you create some content system, so some websites, let's say, where this data is posted, some of the websites have meaningful URLs. And you can parse it and you can find out, that from the URL itself, what section of the website and then what it relates to, for example, politics. Okay? So let me see, I'm just going to randomly try. I'm going to go to Huffington Post and let's see how the, whether they have a scheme or not. So see, they have tech here, right? You notice that? So that kind of gives away, fact that these articles are about tech just by looking at that. Why would you not use it? I don't understand. There is science. It says science. If you look at, I think, business, money. Let's see. So you can see they have money here. And they have, separately small business.
Not that I disagree with you, but just playing devil's advocate, because you have to be careful, because like on the sidebar there, it has stuff about Elizabeth Warren and stuff, and like their most popular articles there.
Oh, these one here? Yeah.
So I mean, that could mess up. If you're trying to extract data and they have some random like advertisement or something on there in the sidebar, that could throw off, if you're trying to extract entities, that could have things that aren't related to what the main article is.
Yes,
about.
It could. On the other hand, if you know how any of the search engines work, this is a clear, significant issues. So, first of all, whenever you're talking about any web content, you really have to understand how you get rid of advertisement and not include it in your thing. And that there's a good bit of work on that. So you can search around and get it. People have developed things. Other thing is, here in this particular case, your point is quite right, but this is what search engines, their crawlers, when they get to this page, they will remove this thing. They would segment and say, this is a story. So, when you look at a page like this, let's say, it's not going to be possible for you to take entire page and simply index it. This is how old search engines like AltaVista and Excite used to do. Because in those days, people wrote, web pages by hand, and they would not have such complex page structures. Essentially, any search engine worth any salt would understand the CSS or any consistent site organization thing that you would use. Almost all sites use CSS. And by having understood that, know which part to pick it up and which part to throw off. There's earlier people used to do it hard way, where they would try to guess which part is the core part and which part is not there. Now, this page is not done by manually crafting HTML. This page is done by some authoring system. And there is a clear, CSS for this thing, right? So you will be able to always, figure out what parts it is and what parts are not relevant to this thing. And you know what part of the page is dedicated there. You always, also, you will be finding out this sponsored link, you will be throwing away this part. There is also, by the way, these things to worth thinking of. You see, success stories. And see, they have done this URL. Somebody, other site might have put, small business / success stories. So, you can figure out how they do it and call it. But I think this is often worth using, because now this gives you clearly the category of main story. These are all the stories. So what they will do is, having done this, they're going to look at all of these stories. And they know that these are main business, they're small business success stories. Okay?
So in this answer, a better approach to find whether a document is a schema or not would be to process the file name of the document, and by looking at the extension or if it is embedded in a HTML page, by processing the header section where you embed the schema details. The assumption is just because the files are hosted at Schema Central website, it says the files discusses about XML schemas. It should be, it should not be the case every time. If someone wants to find whether a file is a schema, XML schema or not, as like in this example. This assumption is not always.
Yeah, and do that, and maybe use the trusted sources like schema.central if they want some kind of a ranking or something.
No, this might be true, right? So the schema.central, schema central website is meant for, it's like a catalog for all the schemas available on over the net. So since this UML document is hosted in that page, he can say that okay, this UML represents a schema.
But Schema Central has a web page for advanced search. So if you treat it as a schema, that's wrong. But if you process the, so when you index the file, if you look at the extension of the file, you can clearly say it's an HTML document or a CSV file, a schema file.
Good.
Got it? Ready? Any sense what they are saying?
Yeah.
Okay, next. How is this discussion about the metadata and assumption and description semantics here on the TechCrunch article? Is there, maybe some how is missing. Is well understood. Mm-hmm. Okay. Anything else you want to add? Okay, Nishita, why don't you describe what Yahoo News Photo and give us interpretation of this?
Yeah, like
processing this page is not easy, but he's not told what are the advantages. Only they're saying that it's a disadvantage, that it's not like regular structured data. And he's not spoken that in the newsML page, like as you said, there are categories for each of the pictures are categorized. He could have spoken about the details of the page. He only said that it is not easy, that's all. He's not said what are the plus points or what can be done.
Anybody else?
He talks about using background knowledge. I'm not sure about news stories. I don't know what it is.
Yeah, that one is not clear. The search engine could use background knowledge about news stories. Since this is on the Yahoo News subdomain, to link up some photo galleries with the relevant stories.
I think what he's saying is basically go and get, like, what's going on in the news. Or it's more likely someone's asking about something current event. I'm guessing is what they're trying to say, like, use Price's knowledge from what's going on in the world around you and try to narrow your point in. I'm guessing is what they're trying to say. That's the only reason you correlate those two together.
Adam, do you have any guess on what he describes by Yahoo News subdomains and what he wants to describe here?
Me?
Oh, no.
Oh, hold on.
I didn't understand really what he meant by that. I noticed in the next paragraph, though, he says you can look at the gallery. If you click on the photos, it brings you to a gallery of other photos on that topic.
Mm.
And you could use those. They were talked about, like, comparing those and getting relative information, but I think the captions were pretty detailed. Like, you click on it, there's also a bigger caption inside there. And he also ignored the metadata from the photos, so I don't think he captured, like, the real semantic details of the photos.
Okay. All right, so I think we have... Let's move on to OC3 then, submission. Looks like only the reviewer number 0i9 has seen the third page, right? The rest of them have all pages. So, alright. Okay, so, what are the, so the basic technologies identified, right? You use a web crawler, ontology, in a way, role of ontology or knowledge is identified. Semantic analysis of image, there's something, some attempt here, interesting attempt there. Well, all right, let's, who wants to start? Vin, what do you think?
I think
describe it.
It's that they wanted to use machine learning to extract the entities to send to the ontologies.
But it's not described how, right? So what does machine learning need? It needs some training set, right?
The one for the talk about video processing, the semantic segmentation.
Mm.
That I looked at a paper on that. It said that that strategy does have a training set where they train the machine. It showed. I mean, they didn't say it in this paper.
Video?
No, for I think the article mentioned it for the all the three things.
Well, yeah, of course you can do this, right? I mean,
completely.
Remember we did, you know, this one here, for example, shows you how you do automatic annotation, right?
Yeah, but then you had an ontology developed by you, right?
There are two ways, right? So in this case, the ontology is developed here as described. But the other would be, I could use in some way Wikipedia as my ontology also, DBpedia as my ontology, right? That you're not developing. So. And I can use those web APIs, the examples we looked at earlier. The first reviewer, first submitter mentions one of the APIs, right? And there are many other APIs, right? You remember we went through one API from the writer, semantic annotation. You give a text and it will give you annotation. We went through that in one class.
Yeah, but even Keynote, it involves some human. Yeah.
Not Keynote.
Yeah.
I'm talking about the API can. Kele, right? So this one. This one continuously builds, knowledge base, and they don't describe how much of that is manual or automatic. Really, humans are in the loop, and then you give it text, it will give you the entities, and it will tell you what type of entity it is. You can build a system with yourself using a system like Gate.
Video and image, right? We can extract the semantic of that. Let's see what kind of object inside the video, and then the relationship between the object inside the video.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's a great idea, but I don't know if it is doable
right
now or not.
That's what training says. You just extract the data set of pixel values. When the pixel values do to the array, find out what it is. You correlate convolution against the known data set.
Mm-hmm.
Here's your high hit.
And then, what is the idea behind using the decision tree for the pixel in the image? Mm-hmm. I just out of my imaginary, so I really don't understand.
So, like, I think what he's saying is the decision tree, like, so here's the paper he was talking about.
Mm-hmm.
So I just looked at it. So they found a cat, right? But using that image, do you know if it's a cat or a dog? So use a decision tree, you find, like, defining features in it, and you go down a certain path.
Oh, so you need to check each pixel?
No, you can't just check each pixel. You have to do, like, a nearest neighbor search. So you find, like, one kernel match, and then once you find, like, an area of interest, you extract those pixels around it. And then as you go through, you compare those pixels to known data sets. And say, like, well, this looks like a cat, but, you know, here's an ear, a longer ear. Could it be a cat or a dog? And you start going down the decision tree that way. So once you get one decision, you cut out horses and carriages and cars, and you start going down just like four-legged animal path. So it's like how they identify the pixels. Is that clear enough?
So the decision tree is on the features of the object rather
mm-hmm.
than, because I thought, how can you make a decision tree out of the pixel of the image? Pixel is like you cannot interpret anything about a single pixel, right?
Yeah, so
it's just
pixels.
Like some dot.
It's like a kernel. It's a bunch of pixels together.
It's like a segment of the image
yeah,
or video.
Like a subset. Just picture a subset of the image. Is what they're calling the, is what they're using to do the segmentation on.
Okay,
guys.
There's some interesting thing this person identified that I didn't see in other places. Like this, look at this social tagging and mostly closed captioning. This is a very interesting thing. I forgot to mention that in my own early description on processing, because the majority of TV content has closed captioning. So a person is essentially listening to that video in real and in real time typing the thing in that goes along with the video itself, no, but that is a text, and you can use that text to, do processing. So that is clearly a very useful piece of information that is available for all the professional data. Obviously, it's not going to be for your home video put up on YouTube, but many of the content that otherwise goes on TV in particular would be there. No, Yahoo news images. I don't think so. Unless this is on Flickr, and then there is, because Yahoo some Yahoo images may come from Flickr because Yahoo owns Flickr.
So I don't know if Google or Yahoo has in the Google image, right? When we search for a term, let's say some flower. So does it really annotate the facts surround that photo, or does it really analyze the content of the image?
Analyze the content of the image.
This is contextual, by the way. So Daniel Shabe is in my list. So this has shown me the images of flowers from my Google Plus connections, I think.
No, she's talking about images.
No, that I understand. I'm just commenting on something. Interesting that this Google Plus has, the Google's image search does is just personalized. You can see these are Daniel Shabe, and he is on my list, and they have put, he's one of my connections, and so they put him first in early here. Interesting. So, in fact, it's possible that on this one, I might have even done the Plus one or something like that. Interesting. Anyway, so the fact is that just a research like that is much easier, but it's quite possible that it's not that straightforward. You can get started with a lot of data or a lot of images that have a caption. Flower in the caption, manually create curated to throw away some of those things that are incorrect, and use that in a training set to learn, and then you can do fairly well, right? So this is a process that can work, especially on the scale that the amount of data that you have, it will work fairly well. And for quite a few images, it will work well. Some level much down there, at least it will come out. So, is this something should have been in flower? Is this really a flower? So that's not clear, right?
Mm.
No, this is holistic flower thing.
The
so there's a text flower here,
mm-hmm.
And probably it's not flower because of this thing here, but it is because of this thing here. So and because I think some of the images around that have flowers. Anyway, so coming to this, any other comments you want to make?
So in that video section.
Not by the way, many would use RDF triple format to build the search engines. But anyway.
So in the video format, it is. Mentioned that it requires ontology to understand the relationship between the frames inside the video. So are they planning to analyze the whole video and then annotate the different parts of the video using ontology? I mean, I don't see a reason for doing
so,
that.
So yeah, I think it's a bit overstepping here, although there is a bit of research. For example, Ramesh Jain had a work, one of his students, Arun Hampakur, I believe, whereby they specifically focused on video during a basketball game. And there is a different model of basketball as an ontology. And different things that happen, the players and the ball changes and things, and there's the event of hoop and making it hoop and not making the hoop and recovery. And all these things are modeled. So you really have to build a very detailed model and these things. But doing it on a scale on many different things is not possible. Only if you are doing it
for generic search engine, this
generic
not search even be required. Who would search the tool?
Okay.
That I want some specific part of me.
They would not expect to find it. So, all right. So. That's that. Let's take a break here on the video. Let's take a break here. So the next will be OD4. Why don't you guys read it? Okay. Well, I think we can start recording.
Okay.
All right. So who wants to describe what is being offered here? We are talking about 0D4. Suja.
Understand what it meant by pages in this category provide information which enables search crawler to take advantage of human effort put forth in allowing machines to ingest. Actually, I don't understand what it meant there.
Looks like in this one they were talking like not just the three specific ones, but those types of pages.
Right? Search crawler take advantage of human effort. What is referred there?
I think it's a structure of
the
section in the
XML.
That's what, how I interpret it.
Because the question to ask is how to process the information, and he said, at the end, he said how to best take advantage of this new form of content for indexing and how systematic information can be harvested. So this is the information that we want to know, right? But he said that based on this, they will decide later. And then so
yeah,
I don't get what we need here. So that's my concern.
It seems for the category A, the paper uses some classifier to detect the content of this page, but it's not clear what kind of classifier it tends to use. And it seems that they have a database of schema stored,
And if this is a new schema which is not in there, it would process, it would inform the maintainers to process the data and put it in the database. So it's about the category.
But still, in that answer, I don't see how do you get the semantics out of that particular event.
Which metadata you index.
So it kind of seems to, you know, somehow imply that the search engine is a variety of schema for different kinds of content. It understands, let's say, it argues that you can understand this type of content, so you have a schema for that, and what that means basically is you can explore the structure of the data, even if you have it, even though it's not described well. But that does not necessarily give you the meaning of any of the you know, items, right? Any of the values that will be, say, tag value that you may have. It doesn't describe what those things mean and how you exploit that. Now, in the, I think there's a little bit more to work with in category, you know, in the second part of it, news article thing, right? Did you guys read it?
I think the author, by trying to explain the the techniques and all these things with regard to any kind of such a document, like unstructured document, is, and because of that he is losing very specific things with this with respect to the current document that he is processing. So here it says NLP, name entity recognition, triple extraction, domain modeling and all those things. Yes, it's valid, but in this particular document, right, that is what is expected in the write-up.
Yes.
How do you, what techniques apply to extract what kind of semantics in the particular?
If you had a search engine or semantic search engine and it was coming across this page, what would
yes.
it understand and how would it exploit and how would it make this page more meta searchable? Okay. Yes.
About the crunch-based section at the bottom. This is something we talked about in the previous class also. So that was interesting. So
yeah, the learn more.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Go to the learn more and
so
extract
that gets
the structured information. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I think leveraging the like stuff intended for humans is pretty. I mean, it's already been tagged, so leverage that against it. And the other papers that talk about leveraging human tag things. It says, while these hints about context. If it's there, we might as well use it.
Yeah, it is missing, and I would like people offline to, if you have done less than 3 reviews each, then offer to you know, do the reviews and send it to me. So it looks to me overall that there is a lot of things missing here that could have been done, at least compared to other articles. I don't have much to work with here. You know, in the image case, it talks about doing name entity recognition on you know, the caption, for example, which is true. But I don't think there is any discussion about how you do how do you use semantics for name entity recognition. Even in the previous parts of this, you know, submission. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, it doesn't mention any use of entity spotter. So
the how part is not clearly explained. How exactly the semantic knowledge base will be used or creation.
How do you compare this with the previous one? All except two of you should be able to answer.
I think the previous one is better in the way that, let's say, I talk about the semantic of videos and image, the objects in the videos and image, and if we can exploit such relationship, that can, I think that idea is good, if we can do it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
What about any opposing view?
I guess it depends on what you're looking for. But you can't compare them together because the persons may have different levels of skill sets in semantic living. Right, so it depends on what
I
you're...
I don't care.
I mean, right now,
that is not...
Not
that's not your concern, right? Your concern is you two things.
The
oh.
Ideas,
you,
yeah.
Both of you, you know the questions. For those questions, you're given two answers, which one does a better job. That's what it is.
This is the seventh paper, and the first one was taken.
This is what?
Survey?
What survey?
The previous one was technical. Mm. He went to technical.
Okay.
Example. The first one was better. I think that the current one it does not exactly address the question that we are asking in this, like what kind of information that we need to process and like how to process. But at least the previous one did a better job.
Okay. All right. Good. These are the opinions you guys have. Is it really close to 5? Boy, the time went very fast. Let's start next class. Close to 3:30 as possible. And please read next at least 4 or so that we don't spend too much time. So get ready. I think right now it seemed to me that most of you have not read this, and so you still come and read the class. That's fine. Right? I'm reading you guys, so.
Sometimes we read it, but it is hard to say about.
Yeah, because all the reading is similar, right?
Huh?
If you read 5 of them, it's very difficult to distinguish in your head because everything talks about same content.
So suppose you were to have read all of this now, you should have read all of this, right? That means you know the comprehensive, potentially comprehensive answers. Right? You all had given one submission. You know what others did better than you did. You can figure out all their good points, and that these are all could have been said. And now you can say, well, this guy missed out all these things, and this guy said all this. Plus, you have all these slides. You have this Yahoo thing. You have this New York Times things. You have number of these things have talked about. Search. I posted just today in this year another article that you should read. This is an article written in 2000 about semantic search, and from this just figure out what you could be doing. We had earlier discussed all this Google Knowledge Graph and semantic search. So by now you have read all of this. If you are still missing something, read this paper. Gives you, semantic enhancement engine paper, right? And these are all the answers are there. All answers in a sense, again, there's no perfect solution to these kind of questions, right? These are open-ended questions. You can do, always do more. But some of the core things are already there. We discussed in many different ways, at many different times. So it should be clear in your mind all the common things you have to do. You have to understand what kind of data there is, what kind of syntax I can exploit, what kind of structure I can exploit, what kind of semantics I can exploit. None of you seem to have asked, basically the first answer did a better job so far. But otherwise, nobody has, created a, it's like, suppose you were to write a survey paper, you need to create a taxonomy of your solution. And none of you have done that very well. Even though I've said, several times, think about structure, syntax, structure, semantics. We discuss that, what these things mean. And for each of those, if you have just learned that, and for each of the three questions, just answer these questions, what structure can I, what syntax can I explore? What can I do using regular expression? Let's say, what can I pull off? None of you have mentioned so far even regular expression. What can I do as a structure? What is in the title? What is in this thing? Some of you have done that. And what can I do in the semantics? And there the answer is very wide. But at least all of you know you can use background knowledge base, you can do classifiers, you can do things of certain nature to identify the name entities and type of the name entities and correlate with, let's say, DBpedia or something along that line. Those things you could have done. Those are the minimal things you could have done. Then we have talked about power of relationships. You could go further in deep in that part. I've shown you, DALI search engine and typed in golf thing, and you remember the directory was automatically created. How did it do that? Ask these questions. This is a prototypical of the kind of things you have to do in the real world. I mean, obviously, nobody, if you are an engineering and a programmer, if you're hired as a programmer, then that's fine. Somebody says, here's the problem, program. But if you're doing any other project where you're doing creative work, and you have to design the solution, you know the problem, but you don't know the solution, then this is the kind of thing you have to do. So it's a, and in today's world, this kind of thing about undefined or poorly defined or semi-defined problem with open-ended answer is the more important skill to have. Or
I think because this assignment is too open, right? People can go like too many directions according to the background. So he liked more of the video processing, so he go into that direction. But I think we should have something in common so that we like, if we put there's something that all of us should follow to when we put our opinion about someone's submission. If like, I'm feeling like unfair for the people that I review their submissions. Because like when I read others' reviews, and say, oh, they're praising. I say, oh, I did a very poor job. I didn't praise them in that. So.
I think that clearly there are a few here that have done a decent job, and some very fundamental message I have given, like thinking about syntax, structure, and semantics, like thinking about metadata, types of metadata, like thinking about core value of NLP versus machine learning versus knowledge-based techniques. These are things, so I just mentioned thick organizing principles, right? Syntax, structure, and semantics, the variety of metadata in each of the different situations, and broad variety of techniques being IR, machine learning, NLP, and knowledge base. This we have covered at certain levels, not in necessarily all the details and such. And if you had just taken these three aspect of looking at the problem and gone through this exercise, you've done fantastically well. Now you can't claim that this was not discussed. This way. But what that tells you is that much of our education is centered around techniques, rather than creative thinking, rather than organizing the process. So that needs to change, and this is very important. Hopefully you're getting that opportunity.
So what if somebody proposed some idea and it may look, I think it is a great idea if we can do it, but we cannot do it by now at this time. So can I put more weight like more point for that submission? Regard like in compared to others? So like
that. I don't think that I want to give you exactly what you know you want to do. In that, it's like the following: how do you you take two search results and ask two people, and one guy says this is a great result from search engine, another will say I didn't get what I wanted.
Yeah. Then what are the criteria
to? I mean, this not this in many of the cases. So, when you write a paper, when you write a review of a paper,
they have certain questions.
Yeah, but at the end of the day, reviewer makes up their mind as to what they want to emphasize. One reviewer would mention that your English is not good.
Mm-hmm.
Other reviewers say, this is secondary comment, I have many other bigger comments to make, and just we'll leave it at that. Subjective. But you have to justify. You do a good. Your review will be considered good if you justify. These are the things that I had in mind that you did not do, that you could have done. We had done in class. We discussed in class. We didn't discuss this.
So we need to write another reviews for.
No, not now. You don't write any more reviews, but you know.
Yeah,
just learn from it.